Very much. I quickly recall what we did last time a little bit. So for X any base scheme, we introduced a category of triangulated motifs on X, DMX, which was defined as the module category over a motivic Eilenberg-MacLane spectrum over X, so MCX, which itself was defined to be the pullback of one which was defined over the integers. And what we ended with last time is that we considered a certain subcategory of this category called DMTX, which was, so to say, the big category of triangulated Tate motifs. So this was generated by sums and so on by the Tate objects, C of n for all n elements C. We had at the end a proposition that this can be modeled as algebras, as modules of an algebra which is somehow additionally graded. So I want to quickly tell you how one can achieve this. So in the first examples, like sheaves on a topological space, we just took as algebra the right adjoint of some adjunction applied to a tensor unit. This was our algebra. So here we have a natural adjunction also from, say, D of C to, say, DM of X. But if we, so to say, apply the right adjoint to the tensor unit, we get here something which is usually pretty small because it only sees weight zero motivic cohomology. So we have to do something else. And therefore, we have the following fact that the proposition the Eilenberg-MacLane spectrum MCZ as an infinity object, MCX, admits what I call a so-called periodization. By which I mean the following. So we look now also at additionally graded objects in DM of X. So there exists, which I call PMCX in commutative algebras of DMX additionally graded. So as usual, we have this day convolution tensor product on this category. And so how should this algebra look like? So informally, we want that PMC looks at least as the underlying object as a direct sum over all Tate, so to say, simple Tate objects. So over all n elements C, C of n. Where, with respect to this additional grading, the object C of n sits in grade n in extra grade n. And so one can formalize this requirement by just saying that, so formally one would say that we have a natural equivalence. So first of all, we would say that the zeroth bit, by the way, I should introduce some notation. If C is any category or infinity category, and I look at Adams graded objects in this, and I have an object in there, then I denote by M round bracket N the object in Adams degree N. Object in degree N. So M is a collection of objects. And if I want to indicate what the nth bit of this collection is, I just write M round brackets N. So here I want, so because this is in E-infinity algebra, in particular the zeroth bit is also an E-infinity algebra in DMX. So I want that there's a natural equivalence from MCX to PMCX zeroth bit. And because that's the zeroth bit, all other bits will be modules over this. So if I talk now about the others, the other graded pieces, I will consider them as modules over MCX, so which is nothing else but as objects of DMX. Ah, sorry. Yeah, now I did something. Okay. That's here the tensor unit. You can also, I got a little bit confused because you can also here, alternatively, you can demand this PMX. So here this condition is just that this is the tensor unit, so to say, set in the module category. But you can also formulate exactly the same statement in SH. So you can demand S PM set X as sitting in commutative algebras in SH X additionally graded. So this is equivalent because of this first assumption here. So the other assumptions, you just want to formalize that it looks like these set n's in all degrees. What you can say is that you also have an equivalence in DMX of the first Tate object set of 1 with the object PMC X in degree 1. And you want that all multiplication maps from PMC X, say K, say tensor over, yeah, because we are in DM now. If we would work in SH, then we would need to write here, I do it in brackets, tensor over MCX, so to say, with PMC X in degree L. There's a natural multiplication map because we have this graded algebra structure here to PMC XK plus L. And we want that for all KL in the integers that this is an equivalence. So, and how to construct such a thing? So either you look at the construction of MC itself, and then there you see, I mean, maybe the first remark I should give is if you use rational coefficients, then it's easy to achieve such a periodization because you can just take the free algebra on Q of 1, so to say. But if you do it integrally, the free algebra has additional homology contributions from the homology of the symmetric groups. So you cannot do this in this case. So you have to find something else. And there you can just modify the construction. So either one, you modify the construction of MC to directly define PMC. MC, say, over Dedekind ring, or so usually this is defined over Dedekind ring first, and you take spec C to be it. But you can also do it differently if you want to avoid to get back to the construction. So what you know is that this, what one can see by more geometric arguments is that MGL, the algebraic cobordism spectrum, is periodizable. And not with respect to the bare Tate shift, but with respect to the 2-1 shift in the motivic homotopy category. MGL is periodizable. This means that there exists a PMGL, which then looks, is it some decomposition into graded pieces? Looks like MGL shift n, twist n shift 2n, so to say, if you want. And that's also a graded infinity ring spectrum in SH. This you can directly. You can here you modify the construction of MGL, so to say, as commutative ring object. but that's a little bit easier than for the construction of NC. And what you can do then is that there exists a so-called E-infinity orientation of MC. So there exists an E-infinity map from MGL to MC. So that's in commutative algebras, this map. And you can then plug in MGL into the zeroth bit of its periodization and take the push out in graded commutative algebras. And then you arrive at PMC. So that's a push out. Yeah, it's probably pretty easy. I mean, this is also not so hard. If you know how to directly construct MC, you just do it in all grades, so this all rates, so to say, the same thing. But if you want to avoid this, I mean, with this construction, you can also periodize other. Every spectrum which has an E infinity orientation can be periodized in such a way. I just want to mention this construction. Okay. Sorry? Yeah, that's in COM. That's a push out diagram in COM SHX to the set. Okay, once we have that, we can now just modify our adjunction above to graded objects. And here we have our PMC then. And now it's obvious what we do. We apply the right adjoint to this. And the algebra I get, I denote now from now on by AX, A index X. So that's the so-called one version of the motivic DGA. I view it as an object in COM. D set, because PM set is here a commutative monoid object, so this will also be one, because this is a lexometric modal functor, the right adjoint, and so we view this in COM DC to the C. And by construction, because so to say, the individual bits here are twists of MC. So if you apply the right adjoint, we will get the weight N, if we look at the nth grade bit, we get the weight N motivic cohomology complex of X. So the cohomology of A, which is a bigraded cohomology algebra, just computes the motivic cohomology of X. That's by construction. And therefore, we can now apply the same trick as we did previously. Then easy to see that if you take modules over AX, we model DMT. So then we achieve this theorem I can also just write DAX is symmetric monoidally equivalent to DMT of X. Maybe I should quickly say the functor say from left to right. So what you do is from DAX, because AX is you get if you apply the right adjoint to the tensor unit, you will get an induced adjunction from DAX to modules over PMZ, so to say. And what you do here is you single out the zeroth graded bit and forget the whole module structure. Take degree zero part. And that's a little bit funny. This is on the nose only a lexometric modal functor, but the composition will be strictly monoidal or strongly monoidal. that's you check it on generators, so to say, and that's you check everything here on generators, and because everything is compactly generated, that's so to say sufficient. Okay, this was this assertion.
Is this diagram defining the equivalence, or was there an a priori other equivalence?
No, this defines the this defines the left adjoint, so to say. I mean, this will first go to dm of x, and then it factors, of course, through dmt of x. I mean, yeah, right, this is wrong. You're completely right. This functor here does not factor through. So, okay, that's a good remark. So this only goes to dmx, of course. But the composition factors through this subcategory. Exactly, sorry about it. Yeah. That's true. Okay. So now I want to just give a remark. So here we use some strictly commutativity of tensor powers of Tate objects in DM. That's the reason why we could take set graded pieces. So if you do something else, if you do cellular motivic spectra, so-called cellular motivic spectra, this is the localizing subcategory generated by, again, Tate objects, namely by the motivic spheres, say S 0 n. You don't need the degree shift because everything is stable anyway. We do it in a stable sense. So we just take all Tate spheres here. And this defines the so-called cellular motivic spectra. And of course, you have also a bigraded family, so to say, of generating bits. So it's tempting to do a similar construction. You can do it if you modify it slightly. So what you can show is that there exists, first of all, we have to replace D of C by spectra. That's clear. But do we have to replace the set also? That's the question. And the answer is we have to do it. So there exists now, say, let's call it an algebra BX in the usual stable homotopy category, additionally graded. We grade it by, so the grading is, so let's, if you have a category C, then C to the C, that's just by notation already. It's the functor category from discrete categories set to C. So we replace this by another symmetric monoidal infinity group with C, with the property that pi 0 of it is the integers. Namely, we replace it by QS naught. So, so QS naught is the zeroth space of a omega model of the sphere spectrum. So the homotopy groups are the usual stable homotopy groups, and that's a symmetric monoidal infinity group. It you can take again with deconvolution the functor category, and these are so-called QS not graded spectra. And then this lives in commutative monads of this category. And then you can you construct it in a similar way like here up. And then there's an equivalence of dbx with shtx. And that was a diploma thesis of my student Adrian Heine. So that's a generalization of this fact. I just wanted to mention that you have to do such a replacement. And maybe another remark is that these periodizations do not come for free. For example, if you want to look at the sum over all evenly graded spheres in the usual homotopy category, stable homotopy category, this is a commutative monoid because the switch map on S2 is the identity. But one can show that it cannot be given a natural E-infinity structure. So in this case, with respect to the two-shift, the periodized sphere is not E-infinity. So that's only for more well-behaved spectra it's possible, so to say. OK. So What else? I have a remark. Yeah?
So in fact, when I do classical theory of PMU, can I make it?
Yeah, that's known. PMU is infinity, of course. You can also realize our PMGL, and that will be periodic, taking complex points. Yeah, that's possible. Good. So, yeah, then of course, if you take, you can also take the all things with coefficients. So if you have any commutative ring R, you can model DMT with coefficients in R. For example, what you can do, you can model it with finite coefficients. If you take AX modulo some M, then you get the mixed state motifs with finite coefficients. And of course, by my remark last time, this is very much related to Ital cohomology. So certain bits of this bi-graded algebra, if you take the cohomology R, is very much related to Ital cohomology of X. Not really, no, because you can, of course, you can define f upper star, f lower star. But what happens is that you take the usual f lower star on all of dm, and then you have to project back to dmt. And this destroys very much of the formalities, I think. I would think so. I mean, you can restrict it to certain cases. In these cases where the relative motives of x over s, if you have some relative scheme, x over s, and if you assume that the motive is of mixed state type, then you can do probably much more in this case. If you, but in general, I would say things break a little bit down. But you can work. We can work with the usual six functor formalism. And if you want, you can just always project to DMT to get a mixed state object, so to say. But yeah. So one definition which I will use later is that R is a commutative ring. And I have a commutative algebra in set graded objects in D of R. I just want to give a definition which reflects properties of AX. If X is a nice enough scheme. So this is called of Tate type. Of Tate type. And now I switch the outer grading. They want that this only sits in negative degrees, additional degrees. Of Tate type, if one, the unit map from R to A, the zeroth bit of it, is an equivalence. And two, A of n is equivalent to 0 for n positive. So here I switch the outer grading. I want that the motivic homology sits in purely Adams graded in Adams negative degree. So this will be how our algebras will look like. And one remark is then that such a Tate algebra always has a canonical augmentation. Has a canonical augmentation A to R in COM. In COM D of R to the set. So which just sends everything in negative degree to 0 and is the identity, so to say, invade 0. Of course, this is all in the infinity sense, so you have to think about it a little bit. But there's a canonical augmentation. And this corresponds, so to say, so you get something like a fiber functor if you tensor along this augmentation. And this corresponds to these weight graded bits, which we already learned about in the last talk. So.
Sorry, Mark.
Yes?
I have a follow-up to Lorenz's question. Mm-hmm. Did you say that the inclusion of
Yeah, of course. This is always adjoint pairs. This has a right adjoint.
Okay, it has a right adjoint.
A right adjoint. Yeah. Yeah, you can always project back. Right. Okay. So we have this canonical augmentation. So now there's a very short, quick chapter on Tanakian categories of mixed Tate motifs. A lot of things were already mentioned, so maybe I just want to mention again Levine's result. So if X satisfies Berlinson-Soule, as we defined it last time, this means in particular that negative degree motivic homology in positive weight vanishes, or non-positive, I should rather say, non-positive degree motivic homology. Then there's a result of Levine that DMT geometric part, so with index GM I always mean the compact objects. In our categories everything is compactly generated, so this means this is the small Tate objects of X. Now with rational coefficients, Q has a natural T structure. Natural T structure, and the heart contains the Tate objects Q of n. Maybe I leave it with this statement. So we can talk about the Tanakian, the abelian category of mixed Tate motifs, and if X is connected, so then this will be Tanakian. The heart X connected, for it follows that the heart is Tanakian. So there exists a group scheme modeling this abelian category, and the group scheme I denote by G index X, and it's an extension of a unipotent group scheme U, a pro-unipotent group scheme of GM by pro unipotent group scheme of GM over Q. So the GM is always there to take care of the weight grading, so to say our twist, our Tate twist, and all the extensions which appear are ruled by this pro unipotent group scheme UX. So say the only simple objects are these Tate objects, Q of n, and everything else is generated by extensions. And we had already examples of these group schemes. So if you take X to be just the spectrum of the integers, then the structure is completely known of these group schemes. Namely, for example, Lie U spec C. This Lie algebra is a Lie algebra of a pro algebraic group, so it will be a completed Lie algebra. So it's free, it's the free completed the algebra on generators in degrees. So this will be a graded, maybe I forgot this, free completed graded, because you have this GM action in degrees, say 3, 5. You can also say minus 3, minus 5, but that's not so important. In odd degrees starting at 3. And you would take a number field instead, so say Q. And you would have a huge degree one part here corresponding to the invertible elements. But Z only has rationally no invertible elements. So plus minus one tensor Q is the trivial group. So you have nothing in degree one here in this case. Okay? Good. Then I just want to quickly mention that if you want to study this geometric pi ones which appeared in the last talk, you can do the following. If you have, which we will do also later for our other fundamental groups with non-rational coefficients, if you have such a situation of schemes, both say satisfy Bellis and Soulet, and say are connected, then we can apply Levine's theorem. And in particular, what we get a retraction. So the fundamental group GS sits as a retract in GX, and therefore we get an exact sequence. We get such an exact sequence, which is split by S, lower star, so to say. And the kernel will be just pro-unipotent because these both have the same GM part. So the kernel, because you have here natural splitting S lower star, by conjugation, GS acts then on K, but the GS action is nothing else but an object in the corresponding Tanakian category. Here it's a bigger object, it will be an int object. And therefore we see that K is in fact something like a group scheme object in MT of S. So K somehow lies in, so better to say the function algebra of K lies in int MT GM. If I leave out GM, it would be the int category, MT GM S index Q. And therefore, this has a motivic flavor, so to say, this kernel, this is a so-called geometric motivic fundamental group of the relative situation. And for example, just applying Tanakian formalism, we can see that if you take representations of K inside MTS, so like this function algebra is so to say Hopf algebra, and you take co-modules inside this int category, such that the underlying object is geometric. And this category I denote by rep MT GMSQ. So inside this category, you take representations of just K. Then you just recover the motifs on X, the Tate motifs on X. It's just a general principle. So you can, these relative groups somehow, the good situation is if you, S is, for example, spec Q or spec C, and for example, X could be P1 minus 3 points or P1 minus roots of unity. Then you have such a statement here. And, yes?
Sorry, I think you said it earlier, but
yes?
Remind me what the geometric motives are?
Right, these will be the compact objects always. So, for example, DMGM of X is by definition the compact object. So, that's DMX compact. So, compact is, in compact triangle category, it homing out of it into arbitrary sums produces a sum of forms. Yeah. And the same for DMT. Okay. So now I want to introduce more general fundamental groups. I want to get rid of several things of the Bellis and Soulet assumption and of rational coefficients. So, and to do this, you have to leave the realm of the usual Tanakian formalism. So we have to substitute affine group schemes by affine derived group schemes. And to do this, I introduce now a general formal setup in which we can talk about such objects. Right. So I start here. It's very general, but you can do it. C is just any symmetric monoidal infinity category. And you can talk about commutative algebras in it. And I just denote the category of affine schemes in C are defined to be the commutative algebras in C op. That's the definition. And FC has finite products, but not in general more limits, because we have nothing supposed on C. But what we can define now is group objects in this category of C. So, so we define an affine derived group scheme in C, or an affine group scheme. I should not say derived, because C could be also one category. So an affine group scheme in C is nothing else but a group object. A group object in FC. And by group, you can define group objects in many ways. And I want to emphasize one way here. So it is nothing but a simplicial object in C, in FC. So an object in the functor category from delta op to FC, which satisfies certain conditions, which I just say now in a moment. But this functor category, you can also cure the functor category from, because you can op everything, from delta, so a co-simplicial object in commutative algebras. Of course, you have to op the functor category then, such that, so first of all, we want that, say, a functor f in here, f of the zero object in delta should be canonically the tensor unit, so the initial algebra, which means the terminal object in FC. So it's just the point, so to say. And the idea is that the simplicial object models group objects. The simple idea is just look at the case C is the category of sets. Then a group object is a group. But you can take the category with one object and in the group G as automorphisms of this object, and you can take the nerve of this category BG. And this nerve completely encodes the group structure. And this we do here in more generality. So, and the conditions which satisfy such a nerve are the following. So F of 0 is the terminal object. Then it satisfies the duals of the Siegel conditions. I mean our F, which is, so to say, a co-simplicial object, satisfies duals of Siegel conditions. This means that a natural map from the object in degree 1, in co-simplicial degree 1, which I denote, say, by F of 1, tensored with itself n times. So there's a natural map induced by certain maps in delta to F of n. We want that all these maps for all n's are equivalences. And then there's, and if you have these two conditions, then this codifies a monoid object in FC. And if you want to be group-like, you can formulate this in different ways. There's a direct grammatic description, which I don't want to give. But you can also say just that the functor it represents on FC. So pre-shift on FC, it represents. This takes values now in A infinity spaces because of these two conditions. And we just want that it takes values in group-like A infinity spaces. So that's the third condition. So I just say that there's a group-like condition, which makes the monoid to a group. Plus group-like condition. So I denote this category by groups, group objects in FC. So that's just this functor category, the full subcategory of the functor category satisfying the three conditions. Okay. So these are groups in affine schemes. And there's one remark. If one forgets about the first condition, then one gets groupoid objects. So I want to omit first of all this remark, first dilemma. So lemma. So we assume fc has, say, finite limits. And this because we want to take a check nerve now in fc. Then if we have a pointed object in fc, so i.e. if we take x to be, I mean, if we have an algebra, I denote by spec algebra the corresponding object in fc. So if we have now an augmented algebra, a to 1, that's an algebra morphism, then this will be just a pointed object in fc. And what we will do from, what will be the trick how to arrive at group schemes is that we just take the check nerve of this pointed object in fc. We take the check nerve of x bullet. So this will be an object, a simplicial object in fc. Fc, simplicial object, which you can see as taking the check nerve of the covering point to spec A, so to say. So with u, that's a very funny thing, because point rarely covers things. But in our case, the point will always cover our objects. So this is spec, the initial algebra, so to say, spec 1. We take the check nerve of this. So what does it mean? We take iterative products of the point over spec A. So we take, so to say, so if I abusively denote this also by x, because x denotes the whole pointed object, then the check nerve in degree n will be nothing else but in degree 0, it would be the point. In degree 1, in simplicial degree 1, simplicial level 1, it would be the point times over spec A, the point. So in general, it will be the point times over x point, and this n plus 1 times. times x point. OK. So this will be, and what is this? This is a derived tensor product. If you think that C is really some nice infinity category, then it will be a derived tensor product of the initial algebra over A, n plus 1 times. Okay. So the lemma says that this is a group object. So that's easily verified, because the check nerves are groupoid objects in general, but also the object in level 0 is the point, so it will be really a group object. So then it follows the check nerve of this pointed object x lies in groups of fc. Okay? So this is how we define our groups. Right. So that's now the remark. In general, we also will work with check nerves of maps where the source is not the point. So in general, if you have a map f from u to x in fc, then we can look at the Czech norm of f, which we also denote by Czech of u over x dot. This will be then a groupoid object. Groupoid object in fc. OK, are there questions about this construction? Yeah? Yes, you understand it completely. Yes, you can view it like this. I mean, for example, if you do it in a category of stacks, if you instead of fc you take stacks, you take point times over, you get some loops. Yeah, or in spaces you take off, you get of course the loop space like by this construction. Yeah, if you replace fc by spaces, you make this construction point to x in fc. You just get the loop space as group object in this sense. Exactly. Yeah. This is also how you can, for example, prove this lemma by taking the Ionela embedding. Definition. You want to, this is now a group object, and we want to talk about representations of it. So what we do is the following, slightly more general definition. If I is an infinity category, and say x from I op to fc a functor, so say I goes to xi, which is spec ai. So the functor to commutative algebras will be a covariant functor from I. Then, so every algebra has its category of modules, no matter what C is. But to take, yeah, no matter what C is. But, yeah, but I want to say C is, say, has enough colimits now, because I want to take, I want to let induced by this diagram category of modules. So I look now at the functor I maps to modules over AI. So this is just some infinity category, the module category over commutative algebra, possible to define it. And this is a covariant functor from I to infinity categories. So this is a functor from I to cut infinity, or to be on the safe side, maybe cut infinity hat, possibly non-small cut infinity categories. And then the category of quasi-coherent sheaves on this functor X, we define to be just the limit over the index category I of these module categories over AI. So one can see that such an object in the limit is nothing else but a module over each AI, such that the corresponding transition map, so if you have a map in I, say, from AI to HJ, that's a map induced from a map in I, then you, and if you have now a module over AI, say MI, then you have a map of modules over this algebra map from MI to MJ with the condition that if you tensor this up, so if you look at MI tensor over AI with AJ, then you get an induced map to MJ, and this is an equivalence. Then this limit is given by such a datum, a module for each, an AI module for each I, together with such maps, which satisfy these conditions. This is how you can define the limit, for example, which appears here. I mean, I just take a limit in cut infinity here. And that's an explicit model of this limit. Yeah?
For the intuition behind this definition, why should I think of that as quasi-complete sheaves and not all sheaves on X?
Ah, it's like yeah, because no, I mean, if you have a scheme and you write it as a, say, by an affine hypercover, okay, then the quasi-coherent sheaves would be modules over each individual piece of the hypercover with also such a gluing condition. Okay. And this will get you quasi-coherent sheaves, not all OX module sheaves.
Even though locally there's no restriction on the
local. No,
that's built into the.
Because you have modules over the rings, this means that you look at quasi-coherent sheaves. Okay. I mean, a general OX module is not given over an affine scheme by just a module. For example, if you take the sheaf of invertible elements, it's not an OX module sheaf, that's correct, but okay, yeah, anyhow. Good. That's the category of quasi-coherent sheaves. And what we want to study is the following. If you have now an augmented algebra, so an object in FC bullet, then you can get an induced junction, or map at least, from quasi-coherent sheaves on X itself. So these are A modules, if X is spec A, to the quasi-coherent sheaves on the Chekhov. So you can view this. So you have here the algebra A. You have the augmentation. And then the next object would be, so that's level 1. Then you have one tensor, level 0. Then you have one tensor over A1. And this goes on. And you make out of an A module and one module, and together with an isomorphism between the two possible push-forwards here, and then isomorphism here. So this is nothing else but a decent datum, so to say. So these quasi-coherent sheaves on such group object, or in general a groupoid object, if you take CU over X in general, is nothing else but a module over the covering thing. So a quasi-coherent sheaf on U, for example, if you take this map U to X, together with a decent datum for X. And therefore, it's tempting to ask the question, when is such a map an equivalence of categories? And this we want to analyze, so to say. When do we get equivalences? And the first proposition in this direction is the following. This is for groupoid objects. If you have a map, so C is again presentable, because, I mean, I need this presentability because otherwise, these tensor ring functors would not exist here. I mean, you can relax the conditions, but I want to make sense out of these tensor products. That's the reason I want to assume something on C. and I take a map F in FC, Y to X in FC, and I assume that F has a section. It's a map from X to Y, such that this composition is the identity on X. Assume F has a section. Then we get an equivalence from Q. Yeah? No, this is now a more general cover. Yeah. Up there? Ah, here. Yeah. This is the point covering X, yeah? Correct. It's some point. I mean, X can have many points, but we pick some point of X and take the covering induced by this point, take the Chekhov here, and look at quasi. Exactly. Exactly, yeah, that's. but we do it. We see what happens. Right. So. But here it's not the point, because we assume it has a section. So it's generally not the point, unless X is. Yeah, it's also very simple. So then it follows that quasi-covalent sheaves on X are equivalent to the quasi-covalent sheaves on the check nerve of this, on of U of Y over X. So if you have section, you are fine. So it, this follows because you can enhance the whole co-simplicial diagram to a split co-augmented co-simplicial diagram. And therefore, you get the argument. Okay. I want to formulate at least the next proposition. So I have to introduce some notation. So what the idea is then to derive descent for this situation is the base change everything to the pullback to X, so to the point itself. But generally, if you have an arbitrary map, say, from Y to X, then we can pull back this to Y. So if Y times Y over X to Y to Y to X, and this pullback has a section. So we see that this situation has descent. And we want to use descent for this situation for the original situation. That's what we want to do. And therefore, I need to introduce some notation. So in general, if you have augmented simplicial diagrams in FC, which I write as follows, and the map between such augmented simplicial objects, so I denote this by such a diagram in FC. And then we get an induced diagram of left adjoints. If we assume still that C is presentably symmetric monoidal, so we can look at quasi-covalent sheaves on these objects. The maps go in the other direction. X here, of course. Yeah. QQX. And because C is presentably monoidal, these are really left adjoints, these functors here. And let's give all these functors names. So F psi phi g. And this is just all the upper stars. And then, as usual, if you have such a square of left adjoints, you get a base change transformation if you apply partially left and right adjoints. So you get a transformation from phi upper star circle F lower star. So you, so to say, take homology, take the push forward along F here. You take, so to say, you make out of a decent datum a sheaf on X. That's F lower star. And then you pull it just back to Y. Or you do it the other way around. You just pull back the decent datum to V and then push it forward to Y. So G lower star followed psi upper star. You get always such a natural map. And in case this is Cartesian here, so if this is Cartesian, I denote this transformation by B U bullet over X, comma, phi. Because if it's Cartesian, then this bit of the diagram, U dot over X and phi already determine the whole diagram. I can denote then this base change morphism by this. So the question is if I should give the next, maybe I should give the next proposition and then stop. So that's, yeah? Then I just introduce a notation. Then I denote this natural transformation by Exactly, yeah. This will be used in a following statement. Okay, and this is the statement which we will then use to show descent in this point to x situation, so to say. So we let f from y to x in f c. So in general, in our interpretations, y will be the point then. And m in quasi-coherent sheaves on x, a full subcategory, such that the following conditions are satisfied. So to introduce some notation, I denote by f lower tilde the map from the Chekhov of f to x, f upper tilde, not lower tilde, f upper tilde this map. And then I want that the first condition that the endofunctor f upper tilde lower star circle f upper tilde upper star, which is you pull back from x to the Chekhov and then push it forward, that this restricts to an endofunctor of m. This is the first condition. On m, the second is that if you pull back to y and start at m, then this is conservative. So you can test isomorphisms after pullback to y. Conservative. The third condition is that this is the most complicated condition now, that you can, that base change commutes with this push forward, so to say. That means that if m is in cube quasi-coherent sheaves on the Chekhov of f, and it's in the image of f tilde upper star, and the image of the composition, even image of m goes to qco x goes to qco c of f bullet. So if m is in this image, then the base change map, which I introduced here, is an equivalence. Then, if you apply the base change map to this, to the following situation, you look at the Chekhov of f over x. That's the one side of the diagram, the Chekhov of f. And we just pull back the Chekhov to y. So we just take as phi our f. Then this gets the Chekhov of y times over x y to y. And if this base, if this natural transformation is, so to say, an equivalence. So we want to, and usually these push forwards are given by limits. So we want to see that the pullback, which is given by tensor product, commutes with a certain kind of limit. That's a non-trivial condition here. And then the conclusion is that then the composition m to q co x to decent data to q co c over f bullet is a full embedding. So we have decent for objects which come from M is a full embedding. And we can also characterize the image, which I leave out now here. The characterization of the image of this full embedding. And yeah, and so to say, then the corollary Yeah. I mean, you use then the lemma to prove this. Because you have decent for the left-hand side, and using that this base change transformation is an equivalence, you can then, and using the conservativity, you can use the decent on the left-hand side for decent on the right-hand side. That's the idea. That's easy to see. But to verify the conditions, that's, so to say, then in the applications, the hard part. Yeah. Okay. And maybe to end, we want to apply the whole situation to the to just this map spec AX, if then AX is the motivic cohomology algebra, which I introduced, and then taking the canonical augmentation in this lies in F and then D of C to the C. And the claim is, if we adjust this subcategory M of the quasi-Cohen sheaves on this thing will be just D and T of X. And if we formulate two boundedness conditions, namely in each weight, the complexes are cohomologically bounded from below, and also in high weight there is no contribution, then this is applicable. And so we see that then the covering of the point of spec AX really satisfies decent. And that's the point. And the Chekhov is nothing else but the motivic fundamental group. This will be the definition of the motivic fundamental group. And if you take, for example, here Q coefficients and take a number field, then this just recovers this GX, which I previously introduced. So that's the so-called, that's a version of a bar construction. And yeah, you can define these fundamental groups as Chekhov's of such coverings by points, so to say. That's the idea. Okay, I think I want to stop for today. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay.
Right. It should be. That's a good question. And the first question is, right, I once thought about this. I have to remember. I think there are some small obstructions. I think the augmentation, for example, you don't have. I mean, of course, if you would, a formal statement would apply, I think. That's not a big deal. But for example, these truncation properties of motivic cohomology, these are not satisfied in SH itself. So for example, to obtain such a canonical augmentation already would be maybe a smaller problem. But in principle, if you can construct such a situation where you can apply this, then it should be possible. Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Thank you.